So I'm David Nott. I'm a consultant surgeon at three hospitals in London, and I donate about 6 weeks, 2 months of my time free of charge to charities. I have done for the past 20 odd years or so, and for the past 2 years I've worked with the charity Syria Relief in Syria. I originally was interested in the concept of making a film in Aleppo, because it was obvious that there's not been any media coverage of the Syria problem at all over the past year or so. And what has come out has been very, very focused on journalists and their problems and being kidnapped and also taken. And some of the stories that were coming out I didn't think were true to life. And so I was quite happy to be filmed doing my work, and also filmed being involved in the charity Syria Relief, and also seeing exactly what was going on in the ground as regards the amount of damage done to both hospitals, the communities, houses and the civilians. That engaged me even more to want to go and take a camera crew with me so we could show exactly what was going on with the barrel bombing and with the total destruction of Aleppo. So I thought it was a great thing to be able to do. I was told just to be myself. I was told to go in and do the job that I normally do, and I was just told that there would be people there filming in the background, and for me just to be as normal as I possibly was, and to just treat the patients and talk to people and to be, as I normally am. I enjoy working with Syria Relief because they're a small charity, but they're very focused in what they want to do. They want to bring humanitarian health aid into Syria. I wanted to be part of the good work that they were doing, and I wanted to show how doctors that are in Syria at the moment may benefit from teaching and training, and for me to leave them with a legacy of how to cope with the serious and awful injuries that the patients are suffering from. So I was very happy to be involved in this sort of project.
Tonight, we take you into some of the few remaining hospitals on the front line of Syria's bloody civil war. Hospitals forced underground because the Syrian government bombs them.
How many patients?
Four killed.
Four killed.
We're with British trauma surgeon David Nott as he works with Syrian doctors day and night to treat the constant stream of casualties. What you're about to see is the cutting edge of battlefield medicine. Extreme surgery in some of the toughest conditions.
It would be a disaster if this little boy loses his foot.
This extraordinary footage was shot in areas of Syria inaccessible to most journalists. It reveals the daily toll on the Syrian people, caught up in one of the most brutal and bloody civil wars in living memory.
Last year when I was in Syria, we probably saved around well over 150 patients and they were young children, they were teenagers who really would have died. And it seems to me that the world has forgotten about them. And so it's my chance to sort of say that, you know, people haven't forgotten about you. I will be taking a risk. You know, there is a chance that I'm not going to come back alive.
While the world has watched the kidnapping and beheading of Western hostages by ISIS, the Syrian government has stepped up its campaign of bombing civilians it accuses of supporting the opposition. Most of the aid agencies have been forced to withdraw from Syria. The British government discourages humanitarian workers from travelling to Syria, but David's going back.
This morning, I do have a few butterflies in my stomach, there's no doubt about it, because, I've heard that there have been some, significant developments.
Syria Relief the British charity David is volunteering for, take him to a hospital in an area that's opposed to the government. Nearly all the doctors have left. Those that remain find wards and corridors packed every day with victims of the conflict. David's first day is spent on a ward round with Syrian doctors, assessing who on the long list needs urgent attention.
She's to go to Turkey with that, really.
Since David first volunteered to work in a war zone, over 20 years ago, he's learnt skills like plastic and reconstructive surgery, which he wants to pass on to the Syrian doctors.
Although probably I'd say 90-95% of surgeons have left, the core group of surgeons were still in the hospital, and they're just there because they really, really want to help everybody.
As well as being short of trained staff, this hospital is almost entirely dependent on charities for its medical supplies. During David's first week at the hospital, there's a constant stream of casualties. The doctors work 18-hour days without breaks.
Pressure is absolutely intense. It is a very, very stressful and difficult pressure to cope with. I felt my life was in danger. I would wake up in the morning with a pain in the centre of my stomach, and that would last all day. And the only way how to get rid of that pain was to go and work. And so I tried to forget what was going on around me, and all I did was concentrate on teaching the surgeons and concentrate on making sure that the patient that we had in front of us survived, or we alleviated the amount of suffering that that patient had.
Nobody knows exactly how many thousands of children have been injured, but over 12,000 have been killed in this civil war.
It's all trenches, really.
Syria Relief, the charity David is volunteering for, decide it's time for him to make the perilous journey to Aleppo. He's heading into the heart of the war zone. Aleppo was Syria's biggest city, with a population of 2.5 million. Once, 2,000 doctors worked here. Today, there are fewer than 40. Hospitals were once safe havens. Now they're targets. Human rights groups say 2/3 of Syria's public hospitals have been damaged or destroyed.
This hospital was above ground when I was here last year, and now it's below ground. And how amazing that they've worked so hard in this terrible situation to put the patients underground. You can see the window behind me is full of sandbags, which is above ground. Yeah. There was 8 patients, and I remember having operated on quite a few of them last year, and the barrel bomb hit the hospital, blew out the windows and killed how many patients?
Four killed. And about 10 injured.
And 10 injured with shrapnel and everything else. Barrel bombs being dropped around.
When barrel bombs explode, the air fills with hot shrapnel. They're dropped from helicopters into densely populated areas. Yet again, the first casualties are children. They're confused, covered in concrete dust. The blast can cause temporary deafness and suck all the air out of the lungs. The makeshift A&E quickly fills. Rarely witnessed by the rest of the world because it's so dangerous for journalists to be here, these scenes are played out every day in the hospitals of Aleppo.
Come on, come on, come on.
As the injured keep coming, David goes to the operating theatre to get ready. A father rushes his son into A&E. In the confusion of the crowded department, a doctor calmly checks for a heartbeat. Outside, another father mourns his loss. The few Syrian doctors that remain have become targets because they save lives. It's so dangerous for them to reveal their identity, many hide their faces from the cameras.
بالرغم من الدمار والخراب الذي حل مدينة حلب بالرغم من الصواريخ والبراميل والقذائف التي تسقط بشكل يومي ومتتالي في المنطقة الموجود فيها المشفى بالإضافة إلى الأبنية المجاورة للمشفى كل هذه الأمور إن شاء الله لن تحنينا عن الاستمرار بعملنا وأدائنا كأطباء
We've been in Aleppo now for the past 3 weeks, and the situation is getting more dangerous. The only road out of Aleppo has been targeted with planes, war planes, all night long. So there's no doubt that the siege is beginning. So we've decided to leave.
I felt really unhappy that I was leaving them and a huge amount of guilt. However, I also felt that if I was there any longer, that my life would be in mortal danger, that somebody would make a telephone call, somebody would come for me, and somebody would take me away.
During David's time in Syria, 5 medical staff he worked with were killed in government attacks.
The doctors that are still there, they're going to stay there, and they're so brave and so wonderful. Unfortunately, I think they'll stay there until they'll all die there.